Hello, good evening, and welcome to St. Mark's United Methodist Church. This is our Wednesday Bible study. We are so happy that you remembered. You remembered to make time for God in this middle of the week, Wednesday night. We are prayerful that God will truly grant you the blessings that you are seeking tonight. Everyone who logs in, whether it's in Facebook, on a conference call, you know, we are looking for a special blessing from God, even if that blessing may simply be the blessing of life. And so we are glad that we are together tonight, and together we are going to go through the Bible, study, ask questions to the Bible, and seek answers together. Welcome again. I always like to start with a music. And so on the YouTube, I found this nice Spanish Christmas song by Michael Bublé Duet, and he's singing it along with Talia. So it's a Feliz Navidad song. I know that you'll be reminded of it as you listen to it. Let's enjoy it as we prepare our scripture readings for tonight. Will be taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 up to verse 4, and then we proceed on verses 8 up to verse 11. Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 to 4 and 8 to 11. So find the scriptures as we listen to the song.
Al viento volaré mi voz con mis deseos a tu alma llegaré. Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, próspero año y felicidad.
Amen. Amen. Feliz Navidad. Oh boy, Spanish is cool. Now let us pray together as we prepare to review the scriptures of this day. Let us pray. Oh Lord God, our Savior, we are thankful tonight. We are grateful to you for your kindness. We are thankful, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you do in our lives. We have gathered tonight through the means of technology, and we recognize your presence with us. We invite you, Lord, to join us. Come, come, O Holy Spirit, and lead us tonight as we go through your holy word. We pray that you will enlighten us, you will inspire us, and you will anoint our lives as we shower ourselves with the blessings of your word. Be with us this day, and be with your children who are on the phone, on the Facebook, and those who will be able to watch on the YouTube. We pray that may they all receive your special blessing as we all go through that which is divine, that which is holy, your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Oh, amen. So, you know, we have a special scripture to review tonight. The book of Isaiah, it's very special. The book of Isaiah is very special, especially this chapter 61 that we are focusing on this night, because when Jesus started his mission, he wasn't really very much focused on one particular place. Jesus Christ's idea of a church was not just one particular building or one physical location. The idea of the gospel, according to Jesus Christ, it is one that is so big and so important that cannot, must not, and should not be confined even to one particular community or group of people. And so Jesus was moving, he was always on the go. He was moving from one community to another, from one place of worship to another, even to the streets, you know, to the neighborhoods, immigrant neighborhoods, marginalized communities, communities of the minorities, communities of the majority, I mean, every community. He made it clear by the example of how he evangelized, how he practiced and lived out, how he exemplified, you know, what he was preaching, to indicate that everybody really is and ought to be included. His kingdom business was not and never meant just for the Jewish people, as it was perceived at the time when he was born. Jesus helped shape, he helped clarify, he brought in a lot of light into the scriptures. Because they used to believe that everything to do with God of Abraham was to be restricted to the Jewish people. But when Jesus arrived, you know, he broke the barrier, he broke the wall, and he made room for everybody, even the Quissicos like myself. Everyone is included. Well, you might choose to exclude your own self, but definitely not a responsibility of God. Any exclusion is our own. God has opened the door wide enough for everyone to be included, to be a part of his kingdom. But what is happening on this chapter 31, and you listen carefully as I read it, these selected verses, verses 1 to 4 and then 8 to 11. I want you to listen carefully to those verses because, you know, they really present a very unique piece of the Word of God. They are prophetic. Those were prophetic scriptures given to the prophet Isaiah. So many years before Jesus was born. And God was giving this message to let people know about what was going to happen when this Son of God would finally be born. And now, listening here to this scripture, you will be amazed at how Jesus reads that prophecy that was made centuries before he was born about himself, and now he is reading it with authority, and he is taking ownership. It's like being anointed in that day. He's being given the authority. He's just making it known that he has the authority to bring to fulfillment every prophecy that was ever made before him about him. This is what the first verse says and following. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and to provide to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. And then he proceeds on verse 8, as he continues to read that prophecy. He says, "For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known amongst the nations, and their offsprings amongst all people. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewelry. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as garden causes what it sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up above and before all nations All the nations. Oh my goodness. So you see, I mean, it's not like Jesus was speaking or reading this scripture for the very first time. It was not a scripture they never heard about. Because, like I said, was a prophecy given to the prophet Isaiah many, 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 many centuries before Jesus was born. And so the priests, they used to read those scriptures amongst other scriptures in the Old Testament. And remember, at that time, when Jesus was born, the scripture was not really the way it is today. You look at the Christian Bible today, it has 66 books. So at that time, not all the books had been compiled yet. Remember, that number of 66 books of the Bible, that include 27 books that tell the story of birth and life and ministry and death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So there was no way that those 27 books would have been there at the time Jesus was born, because it was written afterwards, after Jesus had done his ministry. So now, there is something else here that we got to pay attention to. When Jesus was born, the most important piece of scripture was the Ten Commandments to the Jewish people. And all along with the Ten Commandments were all those prophecies. So Isaiah that we're studying about today was one of the prophecies, the books of prophecies that had been there, you see. And so, and always remember that those prophecies was prophecy is always something that tells you about what is about to happen or what's going to happen in the future. A prophecy is not something that anyone has an experience of. God would send someone to announce a particular message that these things will happen. Sometimes it was a corrective measure, calling attention to giving a warning to the people. You are moving in the wrong direction, and so this was going to happen to you down the road. You have a choice. You can choose to turn around, mend your ways, and so avoid the disaster, or you can stay on your pride and on your self-righteousness and just go your way, do things your way, and do whatever you please. You don't want to listen to anyone or to anybody and come up with all kinds of millions of excuses, to just to defend your own ways. Therefore, the disaster will unfold. And I remember some examples of that that are really famous on the Bible, is the situation of the floods that decimated lives during the time of Noah, the only one and his family who were spared from those deadly floods. And remember the situation, the opposition, I mean the contrast of that terrible ending, the Noah story, is the Nineveh story. And Nineveh, the people were perverse. No one listened to anyone. Nobody cared about anybody. People were focused on things that really did not matter for their salvation. They spend and they invested time and resources. They spend their time and effort, invested on worthless things of this world. And they gave absolutely no attention, no time, and no investment to anything of spirituality, anything of divinity. Anything godly at all. They would kill prophets, kick them out, despise them, tear them apart, destroy them with all kinds of you know better than myself. And God would send a new prophet each time, tried, maybe they would listen to this. It was all the same, yesterday, last night, I got a call from someone who's not a member of my church, is a member of the community. The community that I serve here in Brooklyn, in New York City. And so this person you know, was calling for a different reason, but she ended up talking about the church, the people of the church in general. She was like, oh, yeah, there's certain churches who do not really keep anyone. It doesn't matter, they send white woman, male, old, young, middle age, and they'll get rid of them right away, sooner than later, and so on. She went on and on, and I was like, oh my gosh, do I really need to be told about that? So, you know, the people of Israel were the same, like us. You know, they never kept any single prophet. They would ruin all of them and eliminate all of them. They wouldn't listen. They wouldn't make room for anything that's spiritual at all. And so because of that, God, however, out of his love, he really never gives up on us. God keeps giving us chances, endless chances. Well, there is an end to those chances, but the grace of God is infinite. And so Isaiah was one of those prophets that was sent in that time. And now part of the things that Isaiah announced was really to give some kind of a description of what would happen once this Messiah that they all awaited, this Son of God, this you know, this Emmanuel, this the Savior of the world, what he would represent to them and to humanity. It's just that for the perception of the Jewish people, believers at that time, they really, their world was very narrowed. Their God was a very narrowed God, very narrow-minded God, and very discriminatory kind of God, who choose only one particular tribe, you know, one particular culture, one particular group of people, one particular you know, group of people called the Jewish people, the Hebrew people, you see, and so they called God their God. And the rest of us were, you know, we're the outside. We're considered Gentiles. Gentile means you don't belong. you're not a part of. So you're an outsider. You're Gentile. You're excluded. You see. So the God sends the prophet Isaiah to tell them about what is going to happen. What will be the role of this Messiah that you know, they were expecting. They were looking forward to. And because God does not really tell you exactly the date, the time, and every single detail, it made it difficult for them. Even when Jesus arrived, it was kind of hard for them to actually recognize that this is that Messiah that we had been waiting for all these years, that the prophets talked about. But for the purpose of the Isaiah chapter 61, you know, they were perhaps expecting someone who would come, maybe it would be a child of a reverend, you know, it would be a pastor Q's child, or maybe a bishop's child, or perhaps an archbishop, or maybe it would be a lay leader's child, someone from the hierarchy of the religion, within the religious structure, you see? And they were wrong. When the time came, God went completely outside of religion. All those people that were lined up and given power according to the religion, God set them aside. And he went to a neighborhood that was not famous. You know, God picked up a woman to bring his son, and this woman was not famous woman either. She was just, you know, an average girl, and you know, and in a poor neighborhood, and a marginalized neighborhood somehow. The little town in Bethlehem, as we are reminded every time we come to this Christmas season and Advent season. So the description, however, even though it was read, because you know they read scriptures, the priests used to read scriptures all the time in synagogues and, you know, tabernacles and houses of worship and all of that. But the difference, though, is that when Jesus actually arrived in that day and he went into that synagogue, that place of worship, they didn't call it church at the time. And so when Jesus went in there, he already had a reputation. They knew that he was some kind of a religious leader. You know, he had followers. There were people who hated him and who could not wait to see him go, not just to go to a different other a church or community, but to go by death. And they would do anything. They would never give up or rest until they would see him completely dead. And that's what they achieved on the cross, as we know. But in spite of that, the majority of the people, the large crowd of people, mostly the poor, the marginal, the people who suffered the injustices of those political and religious leaders, religious powers, who persecuted, hated, and fought with Jesus and struggled with Jesus until they killed him. The majority of those people, they actually believed on the word and they identified Jesus as the divine one, the son of the Holy One himself. And so they followed him. They listened to him. You see, so on this day, when Jesus arrived and in that place of worship, the crowd of those who followed Jesus, they were with him, following him all the time. And I'm pretty sure that day, the church was fully packed because someone important, famous, was there with so many followers. And now, apparently, Jesus was invited to be the preacher of the day. You know, in that time, in their custom, I'm not sure if they keep the same custom today. You know, the priest, whoever is preaching, that priest would read the scriptures and then would take a seat. Yeah, and everyone is seated, and so they'll sit down. And then the priest will begin to explain, to teach, you know, to preach and teach the scriptures. And Jesus followed the same custom. Yeah, he read the scripture. They gave him and the Bible was not on the form of a book as it is today. You know, it was like a scroll. So a long paper that they just roll it and roll it and roll it. Can you imagine the entire book, the entire Bible, Old Testament Bible, with 39 books, just roll it on. Now, for you to read, you have to unroll on one side. You unroll it on one side until you find the passage of the Bible that you want to read that day, and then you stop there and read. So you'll have part of the roll on this side and part, another one on the other side. And then in the middle, that's the scripture that you're reading. That's what Jesus did. So he rolled and rolled, unrolled and unrolled. And then he found Isaiah chapter 61. And then he started reading there. And because these 39, you know, I mean, this Old Testament script, Hebrew script, was so long and large, the preacher would need an assistant. Just like Pastor Quissico, I like to have assistants. So there was an assistant who would assist you with the book, managing the script, so that you can unroll and roll. And, you know, it was a holy book, you know, the holy book, highly preserved, highly respected. You know, you couldn't, they wouldn't give you a chance to mess with it or what. Today's believers, how do we respect the Bible? How do we treat our Holy Scripture? See? So in the Jewish community, it is a very tough, it's very rigorous. The rules are very tight. There's no tolerance, zero tolerance. When it comes to the Holy Scriptures, you cannot mess up with it, you know? They will put it in a place that is unique. And you'll always find the scriptures, they were there. And nowadays, you know, you find some Christians who have a higher regard for the scriptures. They will, treat their Bible as a book of distinction, a holy book. That's what the Bible is. It is a holy book. It's not just a book that you can buy, order online, deliver the next day or the next 3 days, and just stuff it on the shelves. You know, your Bible is a holy book. There's a lot of respect to it, a lot of esteem. Yeah. You know, if you fear God, you gotta fear His word and everything that has to do with God. You fear, you respect, you give dignity and honor, and you offer proper treatment. You see, that's how you acquire your blessings. So the Holy Scriptures was not just a book that you just find anywhere. Yeah. In those days, you know, because of the delicacy of the manuscript, it was difficult to have millions or thousands of copies for each person to carry their own, you know, or keep their own. It was highly preserved. The priests kept the scriptures, you know, those manuscripts, very precious. And then when you go, then the priest will come and unroll, you know, and then read, and then an assistant make sure that it's not damaged. That's exactly what happened. So there was an assistant who assisted Jesus. And when Jesus finished reading, then he handed to the assistant. The assistant kept proper care and put it properly. And Jesus sat down, you see, and he begins to teach. But this is what he read in that. The Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me. You see, he has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed. Oh my Lord. I mean, each word in that section, each word is so holy and so precious. You can imagine how Jesus felt. You could imagine the emotions in the heart of Jesus. You could imagine how on his mind, you know, how Jesus' mind was operating, because he, unlike the other priests like myself and other reverends, and you know, we are managing a whole script that, you know, is not really ours. You know, we, along with those we teach and preach to, we're in the same group. We are all just miserable sinners seeking the grace of God and living by the grace of God. We have no authority whatsoever above the scriptures. We have no ownership of the scriptures. We have no power over the scriptures. We are redemption seekers, just like our church members and all those who believe, those who choose to believe on the holy word of God. But we and the people that we are teaching or preaching to, we are on the same side. We need and we seek the grace and the mercy of God. We live by that mercy of God. We acknowledge and we recognize our sinful human nature, and we acknowledge in the presence of God that it does not matter how much good we try to do. It does not matter who we are, the color of our skin, the number of years we live on earth, and the diplomas we have acquired, the amount of experience, the amounts of gifts and donations. It does not matter. We are still sinners, and we can only live as we do by the grace of God. Not with Jesus. Very different. Very different. So when I manage the Holy Scriptures, when I read the Word, when I teach the Word like I'm doing, you know, I'm really very humbled, very humbled. Because I know that I am not qualified. I do not deserve even the honor of just touching the Holy Word. Because it is the Holy Word of God. And I am a sinner. just like my fellow Christians. You see, except, unless, and apart from the will of God, the mercy and the grace of God, I cannot do anything and I cannot get anywhere at all. Not with Jesus. Jesus owns the word. He is the author of the word. And so when somebody is administering something that he owns or she owns, that person has power and authority over that what he is administering or she is administering. That's what happened on that day. It's not like the speciality of that day was that Jesus was reading the word that is holy. No, they used to hear that word from the priest before Jesus was born, centuries ago. You see? However, it marks a significant difference when Jesus, when Jesus comes in and says, "The Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me," and so on and so forth. When that scripture is quoted on the book of John, on the New Testament in general, on the Gospels, when that scripture is quoted, you know, Jesus says then that, you know, these words today have been fulfilled, you know, have been fulfilled, meaning that the prophecy, this prophecy that we're examining today from Isaiah, it was about him, which is what caused the problem, because, you know, the critics and the negative-minded and the people who resisted to believe in him, to embrace Jesus as the Son of God, is, you know, they found it as a huge issue, as a big problem. How dare you? Then they started questioning, discussing, hey, wait a minute, isn't this guy, you know, the kid of Mary and Joseph? And then they went on and on and on and on. Isn't his dad a carpenter? Because they believed Joseph was his biological father. Joseph was not Jesus' biological father. Jesus has no human biological father. Jesus is the divine son of our divine, universal God. The God of Abraham, the God of the universe, the God who created everything. You see? But they went on and on and oh, they, you know, we know how can he, well, how can he say that the prophecies of Isaiah chapter 61 is about him, that he's been fulfilled? But if you listen to the prophecy, to the words of the prophecy, and then you look at what Jesus did, you will see that Jesus was right to say that, because he was curing the blind. He was feeding the hungry, you know. He was comforting those who had lost beloved ones. And he was, in fact, even returning the dead people back to their family members who were mourning for them, crying for them. You see? And healing the sick, restoring health directly. No matter what kind of a disease, what kind of infection, Jesus didn't care to ask. What did the doctor say? What was the diagnosis? No. As long as somebody was brought to Jesus, that person would go home feeling better. Some of those infirmities were a little difficult, you know, a little embarrassing to describe in public. Yeah. And so people wouldn't feel comfortable telling their story in public. We are told of one of those kind of people. They say that it is a woman, you know, who was suffering with an issue of the blood for like 12 consecutive years. You know, she had been bankrupt by going everywhere for help. So, she used scientific doctors and traditional medicine and whatsoever, herbs and nothing. She still continued to bleed. It was a very difficult situation for her. But we are told in the New Testament that when that woman, you know, I came and encountered Jesus. She said, she saw what was happening. Everybody was telling Jesus the story of the disease, whether it was a demon possession or whatever. They were describing the problem to Jesus and begging Jesus for help, making Jesus understand that he was the only one who could help them, because they had been everywhere else, nothing. But how could this woman, this innocent woman, stand in the middle of thousands and thousands of people and just publicizing her disease? It was not an easy one to do. So she came up with a strategy. She said, you know what? I believe in my heart that this is the Savior. This is what I'm going to do. I'm just going to use every strength I have. You know what? If you have a problem of losing blood, you will be very weak, extremely weak. Because strength comes from blood. Blood pumps everywhere on the veins and the muscles. And, you know, it travels everywhere to distribute the food that we eat from our mouth. It's digested in our tummies and transformed into good vitamins. And, you know, and it moves, it becomes blood. It moves everywhere. There's blood every part of your body to distribute strength and energy. If you are losing blood, you become very weak, very hard to walk. You can't stand for long, can't do anything. You'll mostly just be sleeping or sitting on your chair. The more blood you lose, the more weaker you become. That woman was exactly what I just described. She had no energy whatsoever, but her faith in Jesus. You know, can you, I mean, imagine knowing that this is my only chance for survival. You know, my only resort for life. So she pulled on every little left blood, the energy from every drop that was still left in her, after all those 12 years of losing blood. She used that energy. She made her way. I don't know whether she used an elbow to, you know, to create a room to pass, or whether she used a pool. So I don't know how she did it. But boy, don't you undermine the power of a woman. A woman who is determined. A woman when she has faith. When the woman believes in God, don't you dare undermine that woman. It doesn't matter how she looks like. Doesn't matter how small she might seem. It doesn't matter. The woman with faith, faith inside a woman's heart, it is a powerhouse, I'm telling you. That woman defeated the entire crowd, and she found her way all the way to Jesus. And she said, I'm not going to say a word. She just touched it. She touched the part of the robe of Jesus. And she instantly, it was almost like electricity. You see, when you touch electricity, you just go. So in her system, it was like that. And immediately, she was completely fine. Total strength restored. Not a single more drop of blood came out of her. Oh my God. And Jesus noticed that. You see, he interrupted his regular business to address that. And then she confessed what had happened. Oh my goodness. You see, when Jesus in the New Testament came in and said, hey, this scripture has been fulfilled. You are looking at him. I am the one that you just heard about. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed. The oppressor, for the oppressor is a bad news. For the injustice penetrator, it is a bad news. Jesus is a bad day for those who are penetrating pain and suffering to the innocent people. But for the oppressed, Jesus is the good news because he's coming to grant justice to the oppressed. Jesus is coming to bind up the brokenhearted. Are you brokenhearted tonight? Is there something that happened in these last days, perhaps last weeks, or in this year, that really broke your heart, caused you a tremendous amount of disappointment? Have you ever felt dismayed? Have you ever been on a state of disbelief? You can't believe what you see. You can't believe what you are hearing. You can't believe what you are reading. You see, Jesus that we are talking about this Advent season and Jesus of Christmas, he is coming for the brokenhearted. Doesn't matter what broke your heart. It's not about who broke your heart. It's not about who's messing with your life. Jesus is coming for you, the brokenhearted, so that you may experience joy in your heart. You may be able to smile again, to be happy again, to feel positive about life again. And the prophecy about Jesus on chapter 61 of Isaiah proceeds by saying, he has come to proclaim liberty to the captives. Liberty. Do you feel like you are imprisoned on your own situation? Are you a prisoner in your own house? Do you feel like a prisoner in the relationship you are in? Do you feel like you are in jail in that job? Each time you wake up in the morning, whatever's your shift, you're working to work, you're on the subway, on the bus, or maybe you are driving to work, and you feel like you are going to prison. Your spirit is not comfortable, is not released. You feel a bondage in your spirit. Every time you come back home, perhaps the workplace is your good moment, good time. And when it's time to go home, you feel like you're going home, you're going back to prison. Your spirit gets conflicted. Your heart gets broken. But you are going home. You're coming back home. You should be happy. The prophecy that we are studying about tonight, the Isaiah chapter 61, is addressing your situation and my situation. This prophecy is about us, my friends. We should be glad tonight that God is telling us that he really sees what we are going through. He knows our struggles. God knows our struggles. Don't you give up. Not yet. Hold on. Isaiah 61 is a promise of relief to you and your situation, to us, regardless of what that kind of mess that you are involved in. Jesus is being announced to the world many, many years before he was born. He's being proclaimed that when he comes, he's going to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Oh, my Lord. He is coming to bring us the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all who mourn, all of them. You know, we are all mourning in one way or the other. Mourning is not just about a physical death of a loved one. You know, if tears come out of your face, out of your eyes, you are alone and you go to the bathroom just to have a moment to cry. You go to a room and you close the door, you cry. You go to an office if you are at work. If you have an individual office, you're not going to need to go to the bathroom. So you lock your office and you start crying. Something is afflicting your heart. Your spirit is not free. Your heart is not free. You're not comfortable. Doesn't matter how much they are paying you. Somebody's hurting you. You see? Affliction. It eats you up. Affliction eats you up in the inside. People look at you in the outside. That's really all people can see. And they make their assumptions about you. They don't know you because they can't go inside you. They can't travel as far as your heart. They can crush your heart, but they will not see your heart. Guess what? God sees your heart. And God sees your afflicted spirit. And God, on Isaiah chapter 61, many, many years before Christmas, God made it known that God knows your situation. God knows our situation, our struggles, and he cares about it. He cares about so much that he would create Christmas for us. Christmas being the coming of the Son of God, the coming of the Holy One. So that when he comes, then he can bring into fulfillment the promises of Isaiah chapter 61. My God, this is so awesome. This is awesome. This is phenomenal. God, the Holy God, the man above there, cares about you, cares about me, even me. Oh my Lord, this is awesome. I like that English, English vocabulary, the word awesome. You know, God is awesome. God is amazing. God, I love God. I love God. Oh my God. Do you love God? I want you to answer that. Do you love God? If you're on Facebook, text me. If you're on the phone and you've been muted, of course, because, you know, we can't understand each other unless you are muted, tell someone else that is in the house. Just say, you know what? I love God. If you are at workplace listening to this Bible study tonight, whatever time you get a chance to listen to it, I want you to tell somebody, just tell somebody, I love God. You know, there's nothing else really that can acquire you all those blessings from God apart from your love for God. You open your heart, be in love with God, and God will show you what God can do. God will show you, will display to you. God will favor you with his mercies. All you need, love God. You know, we are in love with so many people, and we are even in love with wrong people. Whoops. You know, we're in love, and we spend long time hoping that, oh, I am in love here. I found my big love here, to eventually realize that it's a wrong dude. Don't you blame me. I'm using American English. Dude, I didn't know dude. Is that even in the dictionary? Dude. Oh my gosh. So we are in love with wrong dudes, and now they just crush us over and over and over and over. Does dude apply only to men? No, that's not fair. Because we, the men, we also get crushed by our women. All right. Let's just leave that alone. But the point is, be in love with God. Be in love with God. Be in love with God. And God will take you places. God will be there for you. God will show you his favor, his mercy, his grace, and his compassion. May God bless you, my friend. And hold on to the words of the prophet Isaiah chapter 61. You know, a huge gift is on the way. The package has been shipped from heaven. The package will arrive on December 25th, the birth of the Christmas gift, the true Christmas gift, the gift of God's Son, our Redeemer, our Savior of the world. I love this season of Advent, season of Christmas. It is the ultimate point. You know, it is the highest mountain, the highest point on the mountain of our salvation. There's nothing the devil can do now. Nothing, nothing. The devil can still mess up our body or whatever, mess up our relationships, but that's all the devil can do. Our lives, our souls are on the hands of God. Don't you be disencouraged, my friend. Don't you make a mistake. Hold on to God. Love God. And God will show you something never expected. Let us close in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we just want to thank you again. Thank you for giving us the chance. We do look forward every week. We do look forward for this 1 hour, 7 p.m. on Wednesday. The hour with God. The hour of your holy word. Thank you, Lord, for granting us just that. We pray special blessings tonight. We pray special anointing tonight to all those who are listening on the phone, all those who are on the Facebook, those who are listening on the YouTube, all those who seek you, the people who value you, who amongst their busy schedule, they realize that they cannot miss 1 hour, 60 minutes of connecting with the divine, recharging our faith. Thank you, Jesus, for granting us just that. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I bless your children tonight. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, my friends. I will see you on Sunday. Don't you be late for the service. If you are coming to the church, try to arrive on time, way ahead of 11 a.m., so that you can be seated comfortably, use the bathrooms if you need to, and, you know, sanitize your hands. You don't want to walk in the middle of the service and you try to find out where's the hand sanitizer. Arrive at church on time. Give yourself time. Don't you miss church. Don't you miss church. It is a time of our holiness and our holy blessings. You do not want to miss that. God bless you and God keep you. And I will see you on Sunday. Amen. I love you. Bye-bye.